an epic conclusion as we crown a champion. 8 of the top Hearthstone players from Europe have gathered to dust off their best decks and duel until only one player remains. The winner earns a spot at the Hearthstone World Championship, a $25,000 first place prize, and of course, bragging rights. Whose preparation, passion, and belief in the heart of the cards will lead them to victory? Pull up a chair and find out as the 2016 Hearthstone Europe Winter Championship begins.
Greetings, travelers, and well met. Welcome to the Europe Winter Championship. 8 players from their region have gathered here in Hollywood, California to battle out for $100,000 in prize pool, as well as a chance to go to the Hearthstone World Championship later this year. My name is Frodan, and I am joined on the desk by Robert Wang and Brian Kibler, who's joining us for the first time this winter season. How you doing, Brian?
I'm doing great. I'm really excited to see how the storylines we saw started at the preliminary continue here. Who's going to be the champion?
Absolutely. And Robert, we're back this week in Dalaran. Excuse me. I apologize. I'm still new to the Warcraft universe. It's a really awesome setting. What's it like being back here for week 2?
I'm excited to be here in the, as you said, the Dalaran. And I'm even more excited to open up the Europe Winter Championship with a deck that's more American than both steak and freedom.
So. That's right, man. It's going to be a great weekend. We're not just joined here by the two casters alongside me. To my right, over at the sidebar, we have TJ with Raven and Saw.
Thank you very much, Dan, and welcome everybody to the sidebar, where throughout the weekend we'll be breaking down some of the action and giving you guys a deeper look into some of the complexities of Hearthstone. My name's TJ. I'm joined by my two cheeky lads from across the pond. It is Soddle and Raven. Soddle, we had you here for the America Championship, but you glad to be back for your home region?
Oh, yeah, I'm super excited to be here. Had a great time at the Americas Regionals last week, but happy to finally be back in the big leagues of Europe right now. Really excited to see how the stories develop this week.
And Raven, first time seeing you in the Winter Championships for your home region as well. You excited to be here also?
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to it and just seeing what these EU guys can do, because they're actually really strong players. I just can't wait to see the matches.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to getting into it. But let's take a look at the schedule for today. We're going to start off with Group A, where we'll see Dr. Hippie versus Sarissa. Then we'll see Nick Slay versus Naimna. For the second half of the day, we'll head over to Group B, where Diggin versus Tars will match up. And then to round off the day, we'll see Pokerback versus Bunny Hopper. How the group stages will work is we split the 8 players into 2 4-person double elimination groups. On Friday and Saturday, the groups will play out. And at the end of Saturday, we'll be left with 4 people, 2 from each group, that will play in a single elimination playoff stage on Sunday to determine the Hearthstone Championship Tour Europe Winter Champion. But to give you guys a deeper look into the Hearthstone Championship Tour, we have Nipsh standing by Fireside. Nipsh, how's it going, man?
It's going great, TJ. Thank you so much. And I want to welcome everybody here to the Fireside at Dalaran Inn. We have Ronin looking over us. And then the Dalaran, as you can see outside of the window, it's quite chilly. And the players will be sitting just behind me at this desk. They are able to face each other. So, you know, look into each other's eyes and see, is there the Savage Roar? Is there a Pile Blast? Was the card you just drawn good or not? But they had a really long way to come into this tournament. So let's talk about the format. HTC format, the players, first they had to qualify for the preliminary tournament through the point system, just collecting points on ladder or through online cups, or by becoming a tavern hero. In the preliminary tournament, they were put into a double elimination bracket, and they really wanted to get into the top 8, because the top 8 qualifies you for the regional championships. And we are here, Europe Winter Championship, where they will fight for great prizes, and they have a chance to qualify for the World Championship and represent their region. Guys, join us at the social media, Facebook and Twitter, at Play Hearthstone. Let us know, who do you think is going to win? Who is your favorite player? What is your favorite deck or a favorite card? Hashtag HCT. We really want to hear your feedback. But I think the casters are ready now. So, Frodo, how are you guys doing there at the desk?
Doing pretty good, Nimsh. The fireplace is huge here in the inn, but I think it's just Nimsh size. He looks enormous compared to me last week. I was kind of towered over by everything. It's a really awesome environment. I couldn't be more excited. Nimsh, this is a great way to segue off of his comments. He says, get there on social media, hashtag HCT. While you're there, you can also vote for the players that you think will win or even just cheer on for them. Maybe you're learning about them for the first time. You know, we're very aware that some of these players, we're not familiar with them, are we, Rob?
No, not necessarily, but after kind of getting to know them and seeing what they're about as people, I really think by the end of this weekend, we're going to know a lot more, and some of these players are even going to be household names, similar to how Chess Dude was for the America's Winter Championship.
Absolutely. Can't wait to see the Cinderella stories. Let's meet our players. I think the first one is already prepared. It's Dr. Hippie.
Right, the Ukraine has kind of become this powerhouse in Hearthstone. We've seen players like Nairia, Kalento gather and accrue a lot of fame and well-deserved representation for their region. And Dr. Hippie looks to be another Ukrainian player who kind of brings Ukraine even more to the forefront of the Hearthstone community.
Wow. Show already began in shots fired at Reynad. From being excluded from Ukraine. It's okay, because it's an absolute powerhouse of a country. You're absolutely right. Let's go to our second player introduction. It is Cerisa from Portugal.
Yeah, Cerisa is a player who's very proud of his home country. He really wants to represent Portugal here and prove that despite having only a small competitive population, that they have what it takes to compete at the highest level.
Yeah, you know, I think Cerisa was just really pushing how passionate he is to represent not just his team, you know, his friends and his practice group, but also the country of Portugal, because it feels like ignored on the large map of competitive gaming in general, Rob.
Right, when you look at kind of Europe and where esports really is, you might think like, oh, Sweden, Denmark, and that's something Cerisa is very aware of, and something he wants to change by the end of this weekend. Let everyone know, hey, Portugal's here, we're capable of great things. You know, it's not just necessarily football.
Absolutely. And well, you know, there's a lot of things that Portugal is known for, but I think when you come to Hearthstone, we only know about one player from that country, and it's Ignite that usually strikes a resemblance or people's familiarity. Let's take a look at the poll results and see what people are initially saying. I know it's a little bit unfamiliar with these players, but we guarantee you that some of these personalities are really fun to get to know. We've sat down with them for dinner. We got a chance to chat with them. Looks like a lot of people are already getting out there on social media cheering for Cerisa, but I think that not really surprising. I think the people from that area of the world are very passionate for their players.
Well, Dr. Hippie is also kind of a quiet type. You know, many of the players here have said that, you know, he's one of the players they haven't really gotten to know very well. So, you know, he may be the sort of the silent assassin type. He may not be someone that people see coming.
It's true. I think you draw comparisons to Kalento and Nairia, and he has very similar tendencies as well. He's a solo player. He keeps to himself. He just plays a lot of ladder, more of, you know, the scientific approach. Just instead of having ideas influenced from other people based off opinion, he says, I'm just going to play thousands of games and use my own research as an opportunity to develop my strategies.
Right, and that's super useful. We've seen it with a lot of the players in the America's Winter Championship, right? Instead of just going and finding a deck list and playing that, they actually sit there, build out their own decks, tech in cards that they think make sense. And last weekend, we saw Gorehowl in that Removal Warrior deck. We saw Double Oil and Oil Rogue. So these are these slight innovations that can absolutely change matchups.
Now, speaking of which, the matchups, we have the initial lineups prepared for us. We have a Warrior band on Cerisa's side, and Dr. Hippie got his Druid band. Kim, but what are your initial thoughts looking at the six classes we have here?
Well, we've talked about how Dr. Hippie was well known for playing Freeze Mage, and the Warrior band makes complete sense if that's a Freeze Mage in his lineup. The Hunter is actually a class we have not seen very much recently. Hunter was pretty dominant for a long time, but has kind of fallen out of favor, but it's interesting to see that in his lineup as well.
All right, well, we'll see if we can get a glimpse of that Hunter in this series. Keep in mind, we're playing best of five Conquest with that ban. Conquest, you have to win once with each deck. And we're going to kick things off with that Freeze Mage versus what looks like to be a variant of Arena Warlock having an Arcane Golem combo finisher.
Right, and for a while we were kind of seeing in this Reno lock that was predicated on the big damage burst turn, Leroy Jenkins, but Arcane Golem fits a little bit better in. You don't necessarily need to get the proc from Emperor Thor's hand, so you lose out on total damage, but a lot of the time it's not super necessary, and it's a lot more flexible for your deck.
Ooh, novice engineer. That's already some interesting twists on the Freeze Mage. Now, Brian Kibler, as an astute observer and a big fan of Freeze Mage, can you elaborate on things like the novice engineer, why they would include that compared to other traditional card draw mechanisms?
One of the sort of flex spots for card draw in Freeze Mage is that novice engineer versus loot hoarder, which are the usual decisions. Novice engineer, a little bit less power, so it can't really pressure opposing minions as much, but the fact that you get the draw right away can be very important later in the game when you're digging for an important card like a freeze effect or perhaps an ice block itself.
How come you think that the Reno Freeze Mage has fallen out of favor as well? I know a lot of people were very excited about Reno Jackson Freeze Mage because there's Forgotten Torch and you split Novice Engineer and Loot Hoarders. You know, we haven't seen that in a while, especially because in these tournaments it feels like people haven't brought it whatsoever.
I think that Reno's a powerful effect, but Freeze Mage is a deck that's full of powerful effects. And I don't think that what you're looking for in Freeze Mage is something that necessarily swings the game in that fashion. You have lots of powerful defensive tools that can keep you alive. And in many cases, what you're looking for are ways that you can get around the kind of things people are doing to beat you. We've actually seen a number of players switching to playing the Forgotten Torch variant as opposed to even playing Fireballs. And that's something that can give you the ability to generate a lot more damage in a single game that can help solve more of the problems the deck faces.
Yeah, it's a really good thing that's going to be important to note as well. Some of the small variations of whether or not they play Forgotten Torch actually is kind of relevant against a deck like Reno Jackson Warlock, which has definitely evolved a lot, Rob, over the stages of the metagame. This dynamic back and forth of how Freeze Mage plays against Reno Warlock has evolved a lot.
Right, I think Reno Jackson General, one of the cool things about them is because you have so many tech and flex slots that you can mess with, there's no true end to the iteration, really. As sets are kind of coming and going, Reno decks will continue to change, and a lot of it is just based on personal preference. Like we saw Kazan Mystic was really popular with a lot of the Chinese-American players last week. Remains to be seen if it'll be that case with Europe, but you expect to see, you know, we already see that Mind Control tech. Might Acidic Swamp Ooze. That will see Harrison, but yeah, point remains, a lot of iteration to be done with these Reno decks.
And one of the things in this particular kind of matchup that the Freeze Mage player often needs to navigate is playing around specifically Reno Jackson. Mm-hmm. That in many matchups, you're looking to, you know, try and finish your opponent off over a couple of turns with burst damage, but when your opponent has Reno in their deck, it's a lot more difficult to do. So one of the things that you can do as the Freeze Mage player in this kind of matchup is put yourself in a position where you kind of threaten to just burst your opponent from 20, and if they're using their Reno to gain 10 life, it's obviously still effective, but not nearly as game-winning as if you try and go in with your damage earlier on. Mm-hmm.
The key will be if whether or not you can force Reno Jackson and these big heals to be used before an Alexstrasza from the Freeze Mage. Now, what's interesting is Dr. Hippie had an opportunity to develop a card draw mechanism, whether it's Knob's Engineer, whether it's Acolyte of Pain, but he chose to play a secret. And, you know, a couple of theories jump out to me immediately. Feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, Kibler, which I'm fully anticipating. But I think Dr. Hippie is also accounting for the fact that he wants a hero power every turn he can. So on turn 4, he can Knob's Engineer and hero power. Turn 5, he can Acolyte hero power. And that way he can get the secret out of his hand preemptively.
Yeah, the use of your hero power here for that sort of strategy that I was just discussing, keeping your opponent, constrained in terms of their life total and threatening them if they don't heal, does mean it's very important to use your hero power liberally in order to get pressure without actually expending cards. So I do expect that he'll be trying to maximize the use of Fire Blast throughout this game.
I want to point one thing out here. Cereza, when we talk to him, he doesn't necessarily have the total number of games played that a lot of the other players have. So this is kind of one of those things where this matchup really relies on you understanding it. Mm-hmm. The Reno Lock, I would think, is slightly favored because of the potential to do so much healing and just kind of win out over time against a Freeze Mage. But if he doesn't necessarily have a good understanding of how this plays, it might be something where he doesn't understand what the pings necessarily entail. So very important that he's played this before.
Okay. I mean, I think Dr. Hippie just feels that there's so much removal in this deck that he can't guarantee a lot of value off Doomsayers. And starting from turn 5, you can make some really powerful plays on the board.
Yeah, the Doomsayer really both stops Cereza's current pressure and prevents him from developing meaningfully this turn. And if Cereza's using his turn to life tap, that's a little bit closer he's getting to that possible burst damage range. And Dr. Hippie recognizes that Doomsayer isn't really a card that's particularly valuable in this matchup in general, because, as you said, there's so many ways that the Reno Lock deck can potentially deal with it, whether it's something like Siphon Soul or Iron Beak Owl or something like that.
And what's somewhat convenient about this, too, it could be an intentional or a side effect of his play, is that if Syriza didn't have an answer, he would trigger the Ice Barrier, allowing him to get play the second one and be able to start hero powering. Because the thing about Dr. Hippie's hand is that it's pretty awkward outside of the Acolyte of Pain. He didn't really have many plays to just play onto the board. So he needed to consider ways to dump his cards and use his mana as opposed to just passing.
All right, did he get a chance to ping that Acolyte, though? He gets that Mad Scientist. And I think Mad Scientist is one of those cards you kind of want to have, obviously, throughout the entire game, but it really shines earlier on in its ability to contest the board, kind of what Loot Hoarder does over the Novice Engineer. But right now, it's going to be something where it probably just sits in his hand for a little bit, because, as you guys pointed out, the Arena Lock gets those turns where it starts putting out those big creatures, big minions. So not necessarily a lot of clean answers to this Twilight Drake.
Yeah, I think he doesn't feel like he's under an immense amount of pressure right now, though, so... You know, Twilight Drake is threatening over time, but for now, I think he's still pretty happy to pick up cards like Alexstrasza, which aren't like the 30th card in his deck, which would be really problematic. Now, you did mention that Syriza is relatively new. He has only been playing competitively for a few months now. In fact, he's only finished one time in the top 100. But that's because he said he didn't really start taking Hearthstone seriously until about November of 2015. So this is a really awesome accomplishment to see, you know what, I'm going to start dedicating seriously. And the fact that, you know, if you spend a few months playing since League of Explorers come out, I think Syriza is pretty familiar with this matchup. He's been playing pretty solidly and understanding what he needs to do so far.
Right. He mentioned to us that he's involved in studying biomedical engineering. So that's a pretty full-time thing for someone. And then also just, you know, playing Hearthstone at a really high level. But I have to agree. I would imagine if you get to this point, you're definitely considering all the major maps or matchups, especially with popular meta decks like Reno Lock.
I mean, Reno Lock is definitely a very intricate deck. There's a huge number of different lines of play that you can go through because, well, you have a bunch of different cards in your deck. And this is certainly a matchup that, particularly coming through the preliminary, Syriza is certain to have faced quite a few times.
Right. Now, it feels like you want to develop stickier minions around starting now because you know that your opponent has access to a lot of area of effect cards. Flame Strike will always be a possibility to just completely overwhelm your board. Blizzards and Frost Novas can also really complicate how you develop in the future. A couple of key cards are already in Syriza's hand as well. Lotheb, Reno Jackson itself, and even cards like the Healbot timing is really key. So look for Syriza to just hold on to those cards and really pick his windows of opportunity, because he's the one who has to ultimately set the clock on the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, speaking of timing particular cards, we did see that he just chose to use his Earthrending Farseer here, which I think indicates that, you know, he's considering that the sort of mid-20s range, if Dr. Hippie is able to, you know, continue accumulating cards from these Acolytes of Pain and such, is actually a pretty dangerous place for him to be. You know, the burst potential of the Freeze Mage deck, especially if it is able to get an Emperor Tharizin off, is quite high. And Syriza doesn't really have that much pressure to prolong the game much more.
Well, that's a really good point.
That's an interesting draw.
I mean, one of the things that Reno Jackson decks had a lot of criticism from a lot of control players is that sometimes you just need to end the game. And Reno Jackson, in the traditional sense when it first was popularized, had cards like Fugin and Stalag and not, like board control cards, but they didn't really have ways to end it fast. Alexstrasza plus an Arcane Golem Power Overwhelming. Now that's a quick way to end the game.
Yeah.
Right, we pointed that out earlier that Leroy Jenkins appears to be subbed out for this one. And bringing in Alexstrasza, that's a great way to get your opponent within range, because I believe the exact total damage on the combo is what is it? It's Arcane Golem Power Overwhelming Faceless.
Okay, 16 damage.
Right, so it's exactly 16 damage, and Alexstrasza, if there's no healing, you Alexstrasza and then you combo.
Yeah, what a coincidence. Happens to line up perfectly.
But it is an odd inclusion. It's not one we see a lot in Reno.
It's true.
Despite being a very powerful tool for a number of reasons.
And I'd be curious to see if the presence of Alexstrasza means that Syriza is not playing Lord Jaraxxus, which is the right. Usual 9-drop that you see in Reno Lock. It can be difficult, especially we see that Twisting Nether in his hand as well. You don't want to have your deck full of too many of these very expensive cards.
That's an interesting point, because if you think about coming into a tournament, what are you expecting to run into? Jaraxxus is a very powerful card, obviously, falters in certain matchups. Against Druid, you almost never get the chance to play Jiraxxus. Warrior, you can often use it to close out a game, but you kind of have to look down the line of what you expect to see. Mm-hmm. And if you do replace Jiraxxus with something like Alexstrasza, it might be kind of a really heads-up meta read.
Yeah, I mean, I think that Control Warrior is the single matchup that's popular right now, at least, where Lord Jiraxxus is an extremely powerful card.
Right.
Lots of other matchups, you're kind of using it maybe as a sort of last-minute defense mechanism, which Alexstrasza also does fairly well.
True.
Speaking of Alexstrasza, this is a turn Syriza can play Alexstrasza to be a little bit aggressive onto the board. And I feel like I do enjoy this play.
Yeah.
Because it's still an 8 attack, 8 health minion, which is a lot of resources for Freeze Mage to dedicate to it, especially if they used one Blizzard. They have less freeze effects, and so it feels like it's a reasonable clock, and Dr. Hibby now has a lot of pressure he has to deal with.
Right, you just got to keep asking the question against Freeze Mage. You see that one Blizzard comes out, as you say, Fred, and you just keep putting down threats, see what the Freeze Mage has, and it's kind of the same way against Reno Lock, because the deck is just full of one-offs, so you can never really like accurately predict, I feel like, what they actually have in hand. So it's kind of Hooplings first in this matchup.
And right now, Dr. Hippie doesn't have a particularly clean way to deal with this. He can Blizzard again, which will clean off some of the minions on the board, as well as freeze the rest. Though there will be a minion that can attack from the Shredder that comes out. But he's also, Dr. Hippie really is in a position where he's putting a lot of pressure on Syriza. He hasn't been able to find that Emperor, which enables the big burst damage combo. And we see that Syriza has both Reno Jackson and Lotheb in his hand. Mm-hmm. So the ability for Dr. Hippie to actually find a window anytime soon to actually close out the game is very unlikely.
We are going to see the second Blizzard come out there. Curious what he's going to put that. Okay, so Torch goes face. And he's looking like he's just trying to assemble a condition where he is just able to put all that burst in. And I'm pretty sure he's just hoping Reno Jackson is not in hand.
Yeah, and even if Reno is, he has Alexstrasza to follow it up. The big thing that you're always worried about Alexstrasza is, do I have an ice block up to make sure that I don't die the following turn? Of course, in the back of your mind, you're also hoping he doesn't have a Kazan Mystic, which is decently popular in the tournament meta for at least the Americas region. But when you're in the first match of the day, you don't know. All bets are off. It could be anything. Once the matches have been played, though, then you can go into the second series expecting a little bit more.
Yeah, there is a very different dynamic in the very first round of the tournament compared to later round, because players generally will either go back and watch VODs or have teammates, practice partners watching for them to keep track of what sort of distinctive cards are in each of the other players' decks. Now, though, it's still very much a surprise. And, I mean, Dr. Hippie here, you know, he's played that Forgotten Torch. He still has Fireball in his hand. So he's not playing the version that cuts Fireball for Forgotten Torch. He's playing a version that also has Forgotten Torch. So the exact burst potential that he has at this point is not clear to Syriza.
Right, and Amnesiac actually brought that up. Obviously, he went on to win the America's Winter Championship last week, but he brought up just how important it is, that information war, because, you know, he brought out Anyfin once, spent the rest of the time banned.
Yeah. And actually, Nostum, similarly, he got his Warlock banned in the first match against Chalky when he assumed that Chalky thought that he was playing Zoo, which is why he banned the Warlock, whereas Chalky's very aggressive lineup would have been excellent against his more defensively oriented Warlock deck. So lots of little information battles there that can really make a big difference.
Well, Dr. Hippie picks up the Emperor Thorason. And that card is really good, assuming you have the follow-up to it, because you can Frost Nova afterwards. How good is the quality of hand? He has the Frostbolt, he has the Ice Lance, and I think also importantly, he has cards like Blood Mage Thaunos, which gives even more extended range and complicates the math further for Syriza.
I mean, this is definitely a strong card here with the burst that Dr. Hippie has in hand. It increases his burst potential on a single turn with that Pyroblast, Frostbolt, Ice Lance to 17. But we still see that Syriza has the ability to remove the Emperor from the board, does still have a powerful board himself, and still has the Lotheb and Rito in his hand. So this is going to be a difficult hole for Dr. Hibby to dig himself out of.
Right, I do want to point out very quickly, Brian, you brought up the fact that he still has that Fireball in there. He did not cut it for Forgotten Torch. But also having Pyroblast, he has a lot of damage in this deck.
Oh, yes.
There is a lot of kick here. If he can secure the board in any of his future matches and just go in with all that damage, he does a lot.
Well, it's interesting because we were talking earlier about how Dr. Hippie had used his Doomsayer sort of for tempo rather than on a large board. And now he's actually kind of being punished for that. And you know, he hasn't been able to actually have an opportunity to sort of secure the board in that way, even despite playing multiple Blizzards. He just is still facing down that Twilight Drake that came down so early on.
Yeah, it's a really good point, although it felt like Sarisa still had reasonable options despite that. Take a look at that Roaring Torch. If you combined that with the Frostbolt and the Ice Lance, that is 17 damage you can pull out with the Thanos if you could follow up. But you haven't seen the Reno Jackson, so even though you generally won Alexstrasza against most decks, in this scenario, it's still ill-advised.
You often, I think, in this matchup, want to try to wait to Alexstrasza after your opponent Renos, because it's your best counter to that huge burst life gain. So yeah, you usually want to use it reactively to your opponent's reactive card. So it's very much a chess match of you trying to line up things at the appropriate time.
Right. To Sarisa's benefit, though, his board is full of a bunch of minions that are going to keep pressuring Dr. Hippian. Dr. Hippian needs to answer that first and then have the time to play around that Reno, which is kind of the problem he's looking at right now.
Well, I think he might end up trying to burn here. I don't know if he has enough damage exactly, but he's got two Fireballs worth with Roaring Torch and Fireball, plus a Frostbolt Ice Lance. And that all fits within 10 mana.
Yeah, Roaring Torch, Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance, that's trying to math
23, I think. I think it's 23 damage.
With the Blood Mage as well, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so it is definitely huge burst next turn, but as we know, Sarisa has the ability to both lock Dr. Hippiana spells, well, either lock Dr. Hippiana spells or Reno back up. So he actually has the ability to stall out Dr. Hippie's ability to try and kill him for two turns. So even with that potential Alexstrasza ice block window, I don't really see a way for Dr. Hippie to get out of this.
Right. That's why, as much as I'm not necessarily a fan of Freeze Mage as a deck playing it, I think it's one of those long thought-involving decks that I'm just not ready to play on a regular basis. I have an immense amount of respect for someone like Dr. Hippie, who has kind of proven to be a master of it, because it's not necessarily just, oh, you know, you just stall out and win the game. Mm-hmm. You have to be constantly thinking, all right, how do I protect myself? How do I stop their board? How do I assemble enough damage together? And I really like what Dr. Hippie's bringing in his version with that Pyroblast. You know, he's bringing a lot of damage, and I agree that maybe the Doomsayers were a little premature early on, but Tempo Doomsayer has become such a popular play, I feel like, in like the last 2 months as competitive players go.
The Tempo Doomsayer, I think, is at its best against decks that rely very heavily on that early damage or early board presence. Things like Secret Paladin is probably the best place to play a Tempo Doomsayer. But here, you know, Sarisa has had the tools to extend the game out, and Dr. Hippie doesn't really have a great way to come back from this position. His second ice block just got broken, and Sarisa is playing Reno Jackson.
Yep, this is bad news. Hippie, or sorry, Dr. Hippie, because you know, he's a PhD.
He's 20, but he went to med school for 8 years, Dan, to be called a doctor, okay?
Yeah, not like that other fraud who thinks putting sugar in water is really good.
No,
what's his name? Dr. Salty? Dr. What? Dr. Pepper?
I don't know.
Are we allowed to say that? Yeah, no, it's Dr. Pepper.
You don't sponsor the show, Rob.
So. All right. Great.
Well, I think he needs Frost Nova. He's
there
also going to die to fatigue if he draws a little bit past this.
Or that, that Hellfire over in Sarisa's hand. There's a number of ways that Dr. Hippie is in a lot of trouble here. So he's going to try his best to stay alive with that Frost Nova. But I don't really see a way out of this for him at this point. One life, not going to last very long.
Yeah, he is going to try to draw it out, though, and I respect this. You're in the top eight of the Europe Winter Championship. You got to play to something and hope you win, and maybe get a little more information out of Sarisa anyway.
I think it's also dangerous to reveal too much information. He doesn't have anything that would already surprise Sarisa. Although, maybe if he plays Forgotten Torch number two, then you start realizing he has Fireballs and Forgotten Torches.
That is a good point. Two Forgotten Torches is certainly not standard by any stretch of the imagination, so that is a very good point, Dan. He has revealed that now.
Yeah, he's going to hope there's no direct damage. We know that there is with the Hellfire, and so that's going to wrap up the game. So Sarisa takes a very crucial game number one. Keeping the mage alive here gives him an opportunity to potentially target further.
Right, for honor, for glory, for Portugal. Congratulations, Sarisa, on taking game one.
Yeah, definitely a great start to the tournament. You always want to, we sort of joke about this, you always want to win instead of lose, but it is a big deal to win a potentially swingy matchup like this one. Cereza, his remaining decks, Druid matches up very well against that Freeze Mage, so keeping that in the lineup is very good for him. The Rogue can tend to struggle there, doesn't really have the same kind of ability to burst, then burst again, definitely a big win for Cereza here.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, he's the one that's bringing the very unique lineup in his opinion. He thinks Reno Lock's not standard, and I agree to a certain extent. We saw a little bit last week, but this week it's really awesome to see people putting faith once again in some of our League of Explorers. Now, there's a lot of mystery surrounding characters in a tournament like Dr. Hippie, so let's see if we can find out a little bit more about him.
I haven't talked that much to Dr. Hippie.
Yeah, when it comes to Dr. Hippie, I don't know much about him. He likes to keep to himself.
There are many players of whom you don't know much. There is no much information.
He's kind of a lone wolf.
I don't know too much about Dr. Hippie as a person. But I know that he's one of the best freeze mages in the world, if not the best.
The first thing you find about Dr. Hippie on the internet when you look him up is his freeze mage and how fast he climbed with it in January. But other than that, he's a pretty unknown player.
Это мой второй турнир. Я чувствую себя спокойно, не нервничаю. Просто хочу получить удовольствие от игры. Для меня это новый опыт, новая страна. Я никогда раньше не был в Америке. Новые знакомства. Это довольно весело.
Dr. Hippie doesn't talk as much as the other players, so he's a mysterious challenger to me.
Who am I? None of your business.
Apparently, that was the only sound clip we could get from him during the interviews. I kid you not, that's what the production told me. Like, we tried really hard, and you know what? You know, he is pretty mysterious. The fact that he's so quiet, but you drew comparisons to players like Kalento, and if he ends up being able to go really far, you know, assuming that he's able to get past the series and the groups and consequently win, I think it'd be an awesome, great story just to build the legacy of players from Ukraine.
Right, I was going to say, you brought up the fact that America, you know, is kind of one big thing where we're all like, we have that very pro-American attitude. We're all American, go America. But over in Europe, you have all these different countries that are kind of vying to prove, you know, what they bring to the tournament scene. And he really does want to be a part of that Ukrainian legacy of Hearthstone greatness. And I agree, it'd be really cool if he came out of this and was like, yo, Kalento, Nairia, notice me, I'm here. So really want to see Dr. Hippie get back into the series. He's only down 1-0 at this point.
Well, as some of the other players said in their interviews there, you know, Dr. Hippie is a player who really kind of prepares on his own. A lot of players talk about the importance of working with practice partners, working with teams. But Dr. Hippie, you know, did his preparation for the preliminaries for this largely alone.
That's right. Solo play. I mean, it's really inspiring to some capacity because he didn't need a support group to bring him this far. We'll see if it can take him all the way. We're going to game number two with Warlock versus the Rogue. Now, the Rogue class, this is the only player to bring Rogue in the entire tournament for Europe. Cereza puts a lot of faith in it, says he's bringing a weird lineup. But I'm still really curious what kind of Rogue and also small nuances. For example, I see a very interesting card in the hand of the Rogue that you don't always see in the class. It's a Big Game Hunter.
Yeah, Big Game Hunter is a tech card we see occasionally. We actually saw Hot Form playing Big Game Hunter in his Rogue deck at the World Championship last year, which ended up serving him very well. Rogue typically has a difficult time dealing with big minions, like that Dr. Boom we see in Dr. Hippies right now.
Right.
So it can be a card that that's very important for swinging games back your way. So Dr. Hippie, whoa. For a second, I thought he was playing Reno Lock, and then we saw his hand completely change. So he's actually playing an aggressive Warlock deck that has the Leroy finisher.
We've seen variants of it. In fact, one player from China was, I believe, the first to put
Duke, I think.
Yeah, in Handsome Mechanos, Leroy Jenkins in the deck. And it gives it a lot of punch to finish off opponents, especially because Zeus sometimes stuck in the situation where you need to race a little bit more because you have such good board control and people say, well, I won't deal with your board. I'm just going to try to kill you. And Zeus like, well, actually, I can't kill you, so I'm in trouble.
Yeah, the Zeus, in many cases, has relied on Doomguard for that big finishing punch. But the problem with Doomguard is that it doesn't allow you, if you don't have a minion in play, to combo it with Power Overwhelming. And since the introduction of Dark Peddler in League of Explorers, you can get a lot of Power Overwhelmings in your Zoo deck. So having Leeroy, you have a card that is less useful, sort of a board clear or a value trading type card, but combos much better with the burst damage late in the game.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Fireball, so I'll put a Fireball that I can Power Overwhelming on.
Yeah.
Well, Dr. Hippy has a pretty reasonable curve. He has some of the stickiest minions that are so annoying to deal with. Haunted Creeper, Imp Gang Boss. The fact that he might even bait out Fan of Knives and other of those cards before Implosion is also huge. Rogue has to really make sure to time its AoE correctly here. And a lot of the early game decisions can just completely swing the game one way or the other for a Rogue class.
I was going to say, this opening hand for Cereza, he does have that deadly poison, which, you know, you're expecting to see maybe that Knife Juggler, which we do see for Dr. Hippy, maybe some like Direwolf Alpha on occasion. So it's great for dealing with stuff like that. But Haunted Creeper, a real nuisance, one of those cards that the Rogue usually will have to kill kind of with two different damage sources. But seeing that Prep Sprint is interesting because I think there are matchups where Prep Sprint in your opening hand feels really good, maybe against Warrior, kind of slower decks. But I don't think you want that against Zoo, which, as you said, can put a lot of pressure on really quickly.
Well, speaking of needing multiple damage sources to kill things, Imp Gang Boss is an absolute nightmare for Rogue decks that typically do rely on those sort of incremental bits of damage to kill things, whether it's daggering and hitting it again with something else like a Fan of Knives or Backstab, SI. You're just generating additional minions for that Imp Gang Boss. So the two copies that Dr. Hippy has right now, definitely a big deal.
That Backstab off the last draw on Sprint feels really big to me.
It does,
being able to activate that SI7 agent, start going into what makes Oil Rogue such a powerful class, the ability to get those big tempo swings and shifts. And I think without that, he was actually in a fair bit of trouble. But we do see some useful tools, Blood Mage Thalnos, Blade Flurry. We see a lot of good tools now, but he's still going to be behind on the board. And Zoo's kind of way out in front with the ability to just keep dropping minions.
But I think with that Thalnos, that means the Blade Flurry hits 4 damage, which is a very nice sweet spot for every single thing Dr. Hippy has. Gormok the Impaler, you know, sometimes you don't get the value off of it, but it's a 4-4 minion. Even Imp Gang Boss number 2, all these things have 4 health, which makes it convenient if Cereza backstabs the Haunted Creeper and goes for the Flurry.
Right, we saw Dr. Hippy could have played down that abusive Sergeant, but after Cereza just drew so many cards, it's kind of one of those things where pushing 2 damage now doesn't necessarily seem worthwhile, especially when we know he does have that Leeroy in deck to possibly close out the game with.
How greedy can you be? Do you feel like you can save the Flurry even longer, Kibler?
I think that it's pretty scary here. If you do play, say, an Azure Drake here, you run the risk of losing that to something like just the Abusive Sergeant or Power Overwhelming. And we even see Gormok here in Dr. Hippie's head, so it could go very badly if Cereza tries to get greedy, but he does not. He goes with the Blood Mage into Backstab into Flurry, which will still leave 2 Imps thanks to the Imp Gang bosses, but definitely a much better spot than he was facing down just a moment ago.
Oh, Dr. Hippy picks up Dr. Boom.
Seems appropriate.
From one
match
doctor to another.
He swiped right on that one really quick.
Dr. Boom walks in. What's the prognosis here, Dr. Hippy? It's turn 7. It's time to get on that board.
Well, I think
he's only on call right now. He's actually
he's on his
surgery
lunch break.
Is scheduled for a couple turns from now.
But it's not a procedure Cereza is gonna want.
It's really hard for Rogue to fight against so many tokens without the Fan of Knives, without things like the Blade Flurry. So does Dr. Hippy feel confident enough to play the Implosion now? Or does he want to play Gormok once again and have an opportunity to have a reasonable sized board? It's not exactly the easiest thing to evaluate.
I mean, is there even merit? I think this is a weaker play to be sure, but is there merit in at least considering the Iron Beaking the Blood Mage Thalnos there to deny draw?
I think the biggest thing about the Iron Beak Owl is that you float a lot of mana and you probably are forced to life tap, and your hand is pretty reasonable that you have plays for the following turns anyways. But I think what I do like about the Silence on the Thanos is it denies a card draw. And every single card for Rogue is extremely valuable, as you've seen many times throughout other streams or all the tournament play.
All of chess, dude, man. Just eviscerates.
One card off all the time.
And in games.
I like this play from Dr. Hippie here because it does diversify the threats he has in play. Yep. He doesn't lose his entire board to a fan, like you were saying, if he had played the Implosion here. So he's able to keep the pressure on. And keeping the pressure on and then being able to play Dr. Boom a couple turns later is really exactly where you want to be against a rogue opponent here.
I'm going to say Dr. Boom isn't really an auto-include in Zoo necessarily. You kind of want to have a smaller curve overall, but I see Cereza is subscribing to the chalky way of living, which is if you don't have Dr. Boom in your deck, you're doing it wrong. So.
Literally, the chalky play of the way of living would involve playing a Freeze Mage deck, but
that's fair. He's done it before. He's actually a very good control player.
Dr. Hippie picks up second Implosion. I wonder if he feels the need to tap. I think at this point, the Iron Big Owl still doesn't generate much intrinsic value.
Ooh, that's gotta hurt. So the 2-1 Implosion means that he does need to trade the additional imp in, so goes from having a possibility of having a very big board to just the 2 in play.
I was going to say, it all depends on where you're sitting in the tavern. For Cereza, that's got to feel really good.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, Cereza does have 2 Azdrakes to fill up his hand, and most importantly, he has another Flurry, so he has a lot of opportunity to commandingly seize the board. He's even considering Flurrying now, that way he can protect his Azdrake as much as possible. Because he has other cards like Eviscerate and Deadly Poison to follow up damage.
This is a very awkward turn for him because Flurry does clear out the board, protects the Drake, as you pointed out, but he doesn't really have any other good 2-mana options. So a little bit ambitious, I feel like, though, because you know now that both Blade Flurries are gone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think I'd be opposed to also attacking and then re-equipping another weapon.
Yeah.
You have a Flurry and the Deadly Poison, so you still have ways to make sure Blade Flurry is relevant with Nashor Drake. But at the same time, I recognize that Cereza is like, well, I have ways to be aggressive. Why not be aggressive? Except I don't think he was anticipating Dr. Boom on 7 as a possibility that might put a wrench in his plans.
Yeah, so now Cereza, with that Blade Flurry gone, doesn't really have a great way to get rid of these Boom Bots. He can potentially use Backstab Eviscerate to kill Dr. Boom, but that will leave the Boom Bots in play, and who knows? There's an Azure Drake. They're the natural predator of Azure Drakes, so...
So many Azure Drakes callously mowed down by Boombots every year, and only you at home can help them.
Yeah, I do believe that it is on the food pyramid if you look up the Hearthstone food chain. They'll teach you that in class if you're not
old. The Violet Teacher does give a couple of extra possible targets. I expect, though, we will see, as the food chain demands, this Azure Drake dying. No!
No!
Hold on.
It's still good.
There's also the Wingman Boombot.
Yep, okay.
Wow. So usually it was the wrong target, wrong damage. But usually in my experience, the first Boombot is just a wingman to make the second one look like a hero. We call that the Frodan Boombot.
Okay.
Because I'm never the hero, Rob. Right, I'm always the guy that dies first in the movie.
So you always make Reynad look really good?
I try.
So you try.
A man can only do so much, Rob.
All right. So, Dr. Hippie. That knife juggler.
He can juggle again.
Yeah.
Silence.
That juggler is not working out so well.
No.
Drake.
Oh, that's painful.
Yeah.
Can't silence Drake. Oh, one of the biggest tragedies in life. He's used both of his flurries, but if he picks a Phantom Knives, he will devastate this board.
He's going to pick up a pirate, which is admittedly less devastating in this situation, especially having already seen the one Sharp Sword Oil.
Yeah, that's a good point as well. I don't know if Cereza feels the need to be terribly aggressive here. I think he actually rather just be defensive because he knows that there's still the threat of dying. You're at 9 health. It's not exactly the safest, especially because you can't even fully... Oh, you can, actually. You can clear the board, use the dagger as well. So that's actually extremely valuable because any minion that sticks on the board is a powerful one.
Right, and Dr. Hippie is a Leroy Jenkins draw away from tying up this series.
And this is exactly what we were talking about earlier with the importance of Leroy Jenkins compared to something like Doomguard. That power overwhelming threatens lethal now, whereas if that were a Doomguard, Yeah. It would not.
He would have to tap and then risk. I hope that he doesn't discard it.
Yep. So he's going to have to tap again. Regardless, and that is not Leroy, that's Dark Peddler.
Dark Peddler can pick up Soul Fire or some other ways to generate damage. Oh, that has a charge. No weapon, though, for Warlock.
Warlock's not really, until they turn into Jiraxxus, they typically don't have the ability to give that deck a charge.
Brian, you just called the next meta. It's going to be Jiraxxus Pirate deck.
Ooh, I like it.
I mean, you can South Sea deck and Jiraxxus with 10 mana. Just putting it out.
You can.
Guys, we've reinvented the game.
5 points of burst damage.
Standards coming up.
But the question is, Kevin, will they be expecting it?
Who knows?
After this cast, definitely.
I played my hand too soon.
I do want to point out, though, that in dropping Doomguard from this lineup and having Leroy, there would be a point where you're playing against Warlock where you haven't seen any of the Doomguards, and every single tap, you're just like, you're really tense.
Come on.
Now there's only a 50% chance for your charging death to be drawn.
Well, there always is. It either happens or it doesn't. It's 50-50.
I don't subscribe to that.
Oh, there is a second oil in Sraze's deck,
which is
definitely...
Very aggressive.
Yeah, we've typically seen most versions playing just the single oil, but not quite the ability to actually close the game out here. Doesn't have the mana for oil or anything more than Eviscerate or Fan. I imagine we'll see Sraze take a defensive approach here. He did take a very defensive approach last turn, even just trading in his Drake to keep Dr. Hippie from having a board.
I was going to say, I was looking at possibly just Fan of Knives and trade him the Drake, but it looks like he has something else in mind.
Yeah, trade him the Violet Teacher. Keep the spell power because he has Eviscerate.
That is a silence Violet Teacher, so at that point it's just a 3-3. It looks like he's going to have the opportunity to close out the game next turn.
But he has enough damage.
Lothab.
That may throw a wrench in his plans. He can still play a minion and Tinkers next turn, which I think is still lethal.
Those are two really good draws. If you're not going to get Leroy, those are okay consolation prizes.
I think because of that, he'd be a few points off lethal
still. I think with Lothab plus Voidwalker, Cerezo will not be able to close out the game with that Tinker Sharpsword Oil as he might have wanted.
It's just so scary when you're playing against the Warlock, because you just know every single turn they get two draws at this point.
Yeah, but at the same time, Dr. Hippie's not working with the most health either. I mean, life tapping gets him closer to dying.
Does not play the Voidwalker. He plays the Big Game Hunter, and yeah, Cereza has more than enough damage now to actually close things out.
Yeah, that ends up being the reason he can't. I mean, I can understand why. I think he wants to have the strongest board possible for Power of Warming to threaten. Even if he plays Voidwalker, he assumes that the Lothab will die. But it doesn't matter because the score will say everything. So Raze is going to go up 2-0 and be threatening to win the series in a sweep.
Yeah. So the Eviscerate closes things out. So Cereza in a great spot. Now, he has just that Druid deck left that needs to get a win. And we know that Dr. Hippie has the Freeze Mage deck, which typically does struggle very much in that matchup.
Yeah, definitely.
I'd be really curious to see how many cards were left in Dr. Hippie's deck, because, as you said, he did put power on the board, but maybe he just felt like he didn't want to put himself on the Leroy Jenkins draw to win, because obviously Leroy would have won him the game there, so. And he had the ability to basically draw two times with Lothab and Voidwalker. Curious to see what would have happened there if he'd gone for that line of play.
I think with the Lothab, it was just a combo to Eviscerate that killed him. He was locked out of being able to combo the Tinker Sharpsword Oil. And I don't think we had seen an Eviscerate played just yet, so...
I think there was one
earlier. Was there Eviscerate earlier? Okay. Yeah. So maybe if there's one Eviscerate in the deck that you're afraid is going to kill you, maybe he's just trying to get as much of a board presence, so he's threatening to maybe close things out with just the Power Overwhelming the following turn. So it's a tough call there. He left himself open to dying to what he thinks is one card in his opponent's deck.
Right.
And it just so happened that Cereza did have it at that point.
Yeah, and Rogue actually had a lot of cards, too.
It's true.
So he used both sprints, so... Mm-hmm.
I think he was saying, I'm probably going to die very soon.
Yes.
And I need a chance to... I need to take a gamble right here, right now.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So I think it's a really good play. It's probably something that people are going to look at and just be like, well, that's the wrong play, and... You could take it, but in the context, I think Dr. Hippie played to his outs much stronger compared to other plays that he would have. The polls, by the way, have actually swung the opposite way. Seems people are voting red a little bit more. Dr. Hippie is pulling back and taking advantage over Cereza, despite the fact that Cereza early on was getting some momentum there.
And the fact that Cereza is up 2-0. Dr. Hippie apparently has a lot of faith in him, despite the odds at this point.
Absolutely. Well, Cereza's feeling really comfortable. He's up 2-0. And we are really excited to have him here represent his home country of Portugal. Let's get to know him a little bit better and see what he's all about.
I come from Portugal, and Portugal is a really nice place to grow up because it's so small that it ends up being really quiet, you know. We don't have big cities like Los Angeles. Everything is near you. I just love that. If you ever go to Ponta de Lima, I would definitely recommend you to go eating to a restaurant, to go eat arroz sarrabulho. It's made with rice, pig, and blood, and it's really, really awesome. Ponta de Lima offers a really, really large amount of sports to practice, but mostly I spend my younger ages doing canoeing. We are the biggest club in the country. We are winning the national championships for 8 or 9 years consecutive now. I used to train like 13 times a week. I always kept my competitive spirit. I think becoming the world champion would mean a lot for me, and would mean a lot especially because I want to show the world that Portugal is still on the map. The artisan community in Portugal is divided into two groups. We got the players and we got the haters. The haters usually don't believe that people in Portugal will be able to achieve great things. Portugal is such a small country that they think that we're never gonna achieve anything. And I think they are wrong, and this weekend I want to prove they are wrong. Because I'm here, I'm gonna do my best, not as an individual competitor, but because I'm representing Portugal, I'm representing my country more than myself. I'm Cereza, and this weekend I'm gonna prove that Portugal is much more than Cristiano Ronaldo.
Heck yeah, man. That's the kind of speech I was looking for. And
right.
You know what? He's also already a champion. He's a canoe champion.
Yeah, Cristiano Ronaldo.
I wasn't expecting that at all.
Can you canoe? Can you play Hearthstone? Like, I like Cereza.
Listen, you can kick a ball wherever you want on the field of grass,
sure.
But can you survive in the water with nothing but a canoe? I don't know about
can
that.
Can you survive on the ladder with Seeker Paladins and Druids? How do you handle that?
I don't do it. I don't actually survive very well at all. But we want to remind you guys to engage in the conversation. Let us know what you guys think. I mean, after that, you kind of have to feel like, oh, man, I feel the passion from Cereza. You know, you feel like how he's really emphatic that he wants to perform well just to prove a lot of people wrong. He's saying even in his own country, there's a lot of haters who doubt that he can accomplish anything. So.
Well, he's well on his way to accomplishing something here. He's up 2-0 in the series already. And, yeah, definitely, you know, seeing what he has to say about the sort of passion he has for wanting to prove his country. He's someone who I feel like I have to root for.
Sure.
I was going to say, we saw him holding the paddle, but he's looking to break out the broom and just complete the sweep.
That's right. It's smooth sailing so far, Rob.
We're doing it.
I have a couple of canoe jokes, but I'll save it for later, Rob. I think we're going to see Cereza for a while. I want to pace myself.
I was going to say, Dan, it's a long
weekend.
One stroke
at a time.
I only had one broom joke. I was not ready for this.
You're slacking, man. You're slacking.
This pun war is brutal.
We'll see, man. Dr. Hippie, he's down 0-2. He's going to go Zoo versus Druid, which is one of the better matchups for this Warlock deck. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's changed at all, though. Kibler, you have a lot of insight into a lot of these kinds of matchups. Do you feel like Zoo Warlock and Druid have changed that dynamic at all?
Well, I think that actually the card we just saw Cereza Mulligan into there, Living Roots, is actually a big card in this matchup, giving the Druid a stronger chance than they previously had. The ability to interact early in the game, kill things like an early Knife Juggler that otherwise would usually get in quite a bit of damage, helps the Druid quite a bit.
Yeah, that's a good point. You actually have a turn one play. Druid sometimes would be relegated to coin plays or innervate as the only thing to do turn one. Otherwise, they just pass.
Yeah, in many cases, the Druid would be using its early turns for wild growth and only really kind of developing its mid-game turns and would really either have to choose between wild growthing or wrathing in order to actually deal with the early bird. The early bird. It's early, okay? The early bird.
Yeah.
No, but
I think
here,
you mean the early worms.
Well, there's no worms in this deck. There are a lot of strange creatures like spiders, but no worms. But
I was gonna point out, people talked about how Darnassus Aspirant made Druid more consistent, but this is another argument in favor of Living Roots because it gives it more consistency against a deck like Zoo where it has that bad matchup by, as you said, the ability to deal 2 damage to something like a Knife Juggler or a Flame Imp, or just the ability to propagate some roots on the board, which we are seeing.
Yeah, the damage that you get in when you're using the Living Roots here as just making the minions, it's not just incidental either. It adds up because you do need to eventually win the game. And often, when you're forced to use a lot of your minions and your spells very defensively, you don't really get that much damage against the Zoo player. But if you are able to chip away at their life total, then their life tap does it themselves. Eventually, they're in combo range, and you can sometimes just finish them off.
I want to point out really quickly, we see the Knife Juggler in hand, and we see that Cereza gets the Keeper of the Grove right before his turn 4. Not a coincidence. This is as bombs
summoned.
Go to Azure Drakes, Keeper of the Groves go to Knife Jugglers.
Yeah, it's almost a written rule in Hearthstone. It's more the advanced rule. Ooh, I have to search the internet for that one.
While Living Roots is an excellent card in this matchup, so is Imp Gang Boss. And Dr. Hippie coined out the one on turn 2 and then just drew another one immediately for turn 3. So
that's brutal.
Definitely a powerful opening. And they can actually just feed on those little saplings there to make imps.
I think
what's
even stronger is that Dr. Hippie can even benefit off of the board expanding with the Sea Giant.
Mm-hmm.
When he has explosions, he's got Sea Giants, he's got ways to create tokens for the Knife Juggle. The synergy in Dr. Hippie's hand and board is outrageous.
Truly, truly, truly outrageous, Dan. I concur. We're also seeing kind of the second mode of this version of Zoo, which is the Sea Giant sitting in hand, and the ability to just throw so much on the board that you get the cheap Sea Giant, and a lot of times we've seen it followed up with Enhanced Mikado, and just hoping for that Wind Fury, just go 16 damage all at once, but Cereza is going to have to start dressing this board. Having Emperor Thorazan and the combo pieces in hand, Savage Roar and Force of Nature, feels really good, but it's not necessarily something you can bank on, especially with your opponent still having over 14 health.
Yeah, for now, I think the Force of Nature Savage Roar is not going to be something on your mind at all. It's 5 turns away, you know, in the perfect world, and Dr. Hippie still is in a really good position to just load up the board. 5 mana is also the turn where your opponent started playing Druid of the Claw, so if you get the Knife Juggle out before that, you'll have a really good opportunity to get some good implosions and trades.
You'll also have a really great opportunity to get killed by a Keeper of the Grove, so.
Yeah, but I think you're...
It's the way of the world.
You're still, like, okay with Keeper of the Grove, because they're not developing anything else, and it's very telling of what kind of hand they have.
Oh, yeah, jokes aside, I do agree with... If you can get a Druid to play a 4-mana minion, or 4-mana minion on turn 5, you're feeling pretty good about it. It's the same if you get a swipe on 5. You just always feel good about that because the Druid is not doing worse things to you.
Yeah, they're not using their mana efficiently, and they're playing reactive instead of something very powerful onto the board.
Dr. Abbey actually has a couple of interesting options here. He could play the Implosion, which is a reasonably straightforward play. He can also just attack his Imp Gang Boss into, and this is what we're going to see, generate the Imp, and then play his Sea Giant here, and then trade that Abusive Sergeant in. So able to use the minion generation of his Imp Gang Boss to get that Giant down on turn 5.
A really good sequencing from Dr. Hippie. And I like doing this because even if your opponent had Big Game Hunter, they can't develop much beyond it. And then you can once again respond to the board.
I was going to say, you're just continuing to put more and more pressure on the Druid. So I agree. I really like that last play. Implosion will be there later, and you haven't seen any swipes either, so.
Well, Defender of Argus is actually a very powerful draw. Now that you've seen your opponent doesn't have Big Game Hunter at all, you can really start pushing. So Power of Overwhelming also lines up extremely conveniently for this 1-1 token. This was just a mere imp taking out a guy empowered by the strength of Ragnaros.
An imp who rose to kill an emperor. Sounds like a movie I saw way back in 1990.
I mean, I feel like there are Chinese-based movies like that.
You got the reference, though, right?
I did. It was Gladiator.
Okay, good. Just making sure somebody...
Oh, is it?
Right. There was that whole thing on the opening. It was like a slave who became a gladiator.
Yeah. That's a good MC tech. Not the best, but the second best option there, I think. Able to give him a little bit of a defensive posture here. Lotheb will potentially stop this implosion, but Is Cereza dead?
Yeah,
I believe so.
Leroy is actually able to just close this out.
Yeah.
The two smaller minions are able to take out that Imp Gang boss, and then 14 damage coming through to the face. Dr. Hippie's not out of this yet.
Yeah, it wasn't even really close. There was only one chance to stay alive, and that was to take the Sea Giant. And, you know, the information's out there. The Druid's playing the Mind Control tech. Dr. Hippie climbs back into the series and strikes his first blood, which is important because, you know, you just need to be able to apply some pressure here. Even though you ultimately need to win with every deck, you just want to play your best matchups every time.
Well, that's actually not necessarily true, and especially at this stage of the tournament. I think if I'm Dr. Hippie's seat, even if I think my Hunter has an excellent matchup in this matchup, I play my Mage right now because I don't want to reveal information about my Hunter if I'm going to lose with Mage anyway. So it's important that sort of information battle we were talking about earlier is still being staged at this point. This is just a double elimination tournament at this point, so there's no value to losing by less. You're just giving away information and still losing the match. That's really not what you want to be.
Sure.
Okay. That's a really fair assessment. I definitely agree, at least with the queuing up the zoo here.
That's for sure. You haven't revealed any information about that deck. It's able to, if nothing else, like give you a mental boost of, you know, getting a win on the board, not just getting swept in your first match.
Sure. Right. That zoo deck is also one that we've seen a bit of in the America's Winter Championship and the preliminaries leading up to these two events. So it's not necessarily like you're revealing too much by playing down that Sea Giant, which didn't come out in the first game. That deck is pretty standard in terms of what it is. So.
All right, well, can Dr. Hippie come back? I mean, there's signs of life.
Signs of life.
Okay. I didn't even know that.
That wasn't intentional? Wow.
Wow. Dan has become a next level pun master.
But I think that we're going to see, and it is, that freeze mage from Dr. Hippie.
Yeah, very astute.
He definitely recognizes he doesn't want to spew any information that he doesn't have to here. And I'm sure he recognizes this is a tough matchup, but just wants to conceal his Hunter deck while he can.
It's extremely difficult.
Especially since we've seen Dr. Hippie is less focused on defensive options with this deck and more about raw damage. And against a Druid, oftentimes healing is so important. If you can somehow dodge the Ancient of Lore draw into them getting more cards, you can kind of try to stall them out a little bit. But being so focused on the offensive, I think actually makes this bad matchup slightly worse for Dr. Hippie.
Yeah, I believe we saw all but one card in his deck last game. He had one card left, and we didn't see an Archmage Antonitis. Is one sort of fairly common card that we didn't see. We saw both two copies of Fireball, two copies of Torch. So that's sort of where his extra damage comes from, right. I think, that you often get from Archmage Antonitis.
We didn't see a Healbot either.
We also did not see a Healbot. It could be that his last card was a Healbot. But I didn't go through and track. I think we actually only saw one of his Ice Lances. So I think that last card is probably Ice Lance.
Yeah, he could hypothetically have replaced the Archmage Antonitis, which is a damage source, with the Forgotten Torch's Mayhem Generation. And also, he's playing like two Blizzards, so maybe he has no Flame Strike.
We didn't see Flame Strike.
It is a stylized deck from Dr. Hippie. So I'm really curious to see if he can take down this Druid. We've seen it happen before, and with the advent of Emperor Thorsen, definitely improved Freeze Mage win rates against Druid by a pretty significant margin, but it's still a very difficult matchup. And at least he has cards to play, though. I mean, some of the big challenges is that Druid can hit an early curve, and you have nothing to do but hero power.
Well, and here, Druid actually has a very poor curve. Cereza with nothing but fives here, nothing to do on turn three. He could Savage Roar to kill this Acolyte of Pain, but that's really not what you want to be doing with your Savage Roar. You want to be killing your opponent with that, not Acolyte of Pain.
I think it's important to deny draw, though, and if you're going to hero power, you're giving your opponent at least an additional card. Mm-hmm. So I think there is merit to using Savage Roar. You do have two Azure Drakes and Druid the Claw, so you can put on pressure and still draw some cards, but I guess the reason doesn't feel comfortable at all.
I agree with the idea of just using Savage Roar there, and we've seen it more and more as players are kind of willing to break up that combo, use them pretty much for the utility. I guess Force of Nature, Savage Roar together obviously does a lot of damage, but being able to deny card draw to a Freeze Mage is super important, as the more cards they draw, the more answers they're drawing, and that's always bad for you no matter what class you're playing as.
Yeah, it's definitely rough. Cereza here finally is able to, he draws a 4-drop, but I think he's going to use that coin into the Druid of the Claw here.
Where shall I strike?
Certainly the most reasonable play, because he has three 5-drops, so we definitely need to get it out of his hand.
Well, he would run the risk if he played Piloted Shredder that his opponent could have, say, a Frostbolt that could just get the Piloted Shredder off the board, and potentially even give him something those Acolytes could attack into for card draw.
Right, and he did see two Forgotten Torches, so it's kind of just like having extra Frostbolts at that point, in terms of what it does for a Shredder anyway.
Exactly.
Dr. Tape going to draw with one of the Acolytes attacking into it. Has a lot of draw now that we see plays available to him. He has two Doomsayers as well. One of the things that you have to also evaluate is when you can get away with Doomsayers in this matchup. I think that's also one of the defining things about whether or not you can beat Druid. But so far, he's seen his opponent didn't really have a curve, didn't really use Keeper of the Grove to silence an Acolyte. So I think he's feeling pretty confident still right now.
All right, and Cerez is just happy to be a part of the game at this point, being able to play cards. We see that Innervate come out. Would have been a lot nicer earlier on, but there's still room to mess around with it since he did keep that Savage Roar.
Yeah, turn 7 is a Force Nature Savage Roar, and that can be upwards to, if he just keeps one minion, it'd be 20 damage.
Right. Cerez kind of tripping up right now whether he should be killing this Acolyte of Pain and basically sparing 4 damage from Dr. Hippie's face, or just pretty much go face and let Dr. Hippie draw 2 more cards. Because if you think about it, if he's pinging his Acolyte, he's always working, or for the next 2 turns, or next 1 turn rather, he'd be using 2 less mana, so he's developing less. He's using less in terms of controlling the board. And getting 4 damage is very important in right now, I think.
Yeah, I like going face here. If you do attack the Acolyte, you give up that damage, and I think that you need to actually be applying that pressure here. Dr. Hippie's already gotten a lot of card draw here. And I think that you're more concerned about sort of turning the corner now that you've finally gotten to the stage where you're able to develop minions.
Okay, well, Dr. Hippie picks up more card draw, gonna first push in the Acolyte. He's actually at the limit of how much he can hold.
And Dr. Hippie, he may use Blizzard here. He could use Fireball to take care of one of the minions. The Blizzard isn't terribly attractive because does it actually kill either minion?
It doesn't kill any minions, nor does it really feel like it sets up anything very good the following turn. You'd almost be forced to Blizzard again
right,
if you
exactly.
wanted to stop, and I don't think that's a really good way to chain your freezes. Dr. Hippie picks up another Ice Block here, which also means that Mad Scientist is on the verge of being irrelevant if he draws that too, which is scary because you just want... it's not the fact that even Scientist can just pull a secret, but it must be a dead draw when you need to fish for something else. This is a tough position as a freeze mage. I think a lot of people have been familiar having played this deck.
I was going to say, maybe double Doomsayer here. No, it looks like he's not going to double Doomsayer, but I just don't imagine that Doomsayer survives. Now, he had to get rid of cards because he was at 10, but I almost just feel like playing double Doomsayer. Well, the Druid has so many cards, and you haven't seen Swipes, you haven't seen a Keeper of the Grove, you haven't seen a Force of Nature, so maybe you figure the second Doomsayer is also not going to live.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good point. You just feel like the second Doomsayer doesn't accomplish very much. And you also have Blizzards, and you've seen that your opponent doesn't have the Keeper of the Grove. We know that he's just drawn it, but he had an opportunity to play it multiple times. Maybe he feels like he wants to keep it against the Doomsayers as well. So it's one of those things where Dr. Hippie feels like he keeps his options more flexible. And the big thing is that Thanos gets to draw a card because his hand is still looking a little awkward. Or rather still have other stuff to do.
He has so much cycle and he has so much damage. I don't know to the viewers at home if it looks it, but this is actually to me a very strange version of Freeze Mage in what it's trying to accomplish. I don't know what you're looking for all that damage for. Like, Brian, is there anything you would think, oh, I need to have all this damage to win the game? Is it Reno Lock? Is it against Warrior?
Well, I think if you are not playing the Archmage Antonitis, you will need the ability to burn players through a lot of life gain. And I think that is the sort of rationale, I would imagine, goes into constructing this particular build of Freeze Mage.
Yeah, I think the big thing when you build a deck like this is that you actually focus a lot more on burst finishes because you're going to be heavily dependent on Emperor Thorazin, which Dr. Hippie has never had access to conveniently. When you have things like Forgotten Torches and you reduce it to 2 mana, even with the Roaring Torch, the 6 mana version, you can burst for like 23 to 25 damage if you get the optimal Ice Lances as well. So
Mind control tech value!
Oh.
We're doing it.
Take the silence, Doomsayer.
I mean, obviously, no matter what he gets, it's yeah. pretty unimpactful here.
Ooh.
And yeah, I think you might
that
just want
is,
to play Thorsen.
That is, fairly impactful, is the Emperor Thorsen. He could Thorsen innervate MC tech if he really wanted to.
I like it for style points because you can't let this window pass to get value off the MC tech.
No, he's actually just going to go with Force Roar, though, it looks like. He just wants to crack this ice block immediately.
And if it was Ice Barrier, he'd just win the game.
Yeah.
So I think there's a lot of upside to this play. He's saying, if you don't have it, I'll kill you. And if you do have it, I have Swipe to back it up.
But you don't get the mind control tech value.
He's got a point, Dan. The man's speaking truth right now.
Yeah, I have no counterplay to that. So,
and I like this here, killing the mad scientist, right? Oh, actually.
Oh.
Ooh, Cereza. Oh, no. I was actually saying I like the play, then I realized the disaster that was happening.
Brian, did you just like the wrong play?
That was actually. Oh, we see Cereza.
Oh, no.
I actually didn't think that through. Just like Cereza did, which is that you don't want to give your opponent the second ice block off to that scientist afterward, but you don't really consider the fact that there's an ice block or ice barrier left in the deck.
Cold so as ice.
I can see how that happened, because literally I made the exact same mistake mentally that Cereza did right there.
Dr. Hippie just kept staring at Cereza the entire time, too. Just kept glancing up from his monitor and staring at him, because he sees a physical reaction knowing what happened.
Right, and Cereza had a very obvious visual cue that he himself knew that this was an accident, not what he wanted to happen. Let's evaluate, though, that play. How far back do you think it sets him?
It's still in the situation where Cereza can swipe and pop the ice block, which is really key. But Dr. Hippie has plays afterwards. In fact, he can Alex Strausser right afterwards and keep himself alive. And if Cereza swipes, that consumes most of his turn here.
Well, there's a Drew to the Claw, though, which will give him the swipe remaining, which I think is actually it's actually not clear which one you want.
Right. The thing about swipe is you get to develop this Pilot Shredder, too.
Yeah, and you clear off those 1-1s, which are actually not irrelevant here.
Right. Yeah, being able to generate armor is fairly important for the Druid. Even those small bits of armor can be really useful. Mind control tech still on the table, but at this point, I think you're good to let that one go.
My brain is clearly just not woken up there, because there is still that Doomsday right there. So developing initial minion, not really relevant.
So that's why the Alex Straza is huge, because Cereza's saying, if you don't have Alex, I'll just swipe you next turn. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Hippie has it. So this is a brand new game, and Cereza might have given this one opening for Dr. Hippie to paddle his way back in the series.
I just want you to know.
It made eye contact as I finished that sentence.
It definitely, you did assert dominance. I feel thoroughly dominated in my pun game. I have one more planned, but Dan, you were talking all weekend about how you're like, no, I got jokes this weekend. I got jokes.
We all have to level up.
I'm just
one step at a time.
Punning with the master.
All right, Force of Nature is something you want.
Definitely a pretty important card here for Cereza.
But Hippie has chain freezes, and he can also set up a lot of ways to just kill his opponent if he draws into a little bit more. He's got Blizzard and Frost Nova, and he's got Ice Block in hand already. I'm really feeling scared unless Cereza picks up a Big Game Hunter in the next draw or two.
If he does find his second Savage Roar, he does have the ability to potentially close things out with the Force Roar and swipe over two turns.
Yes.
In terms of getting that Big Game Hunter, though, Cereza does have a few draws here if he chooses to use the Ancient Lore.
All right, well, that could potentially silence one of his guys. Doesn't really do much here, though.
Well, he can silence, swipe, and swipe.
Yeah. Swipe isn't bad.
Shredder in, swipe, get rid of the Mad Scientist as well.
I think it's okay, too, because you've seen two Doomsayers, and the only thing that you'd be afraid of remaining is probably Antonius just dropped onto the board. But you've seen two Forgotten Torches, you've seen the fireballs. I think you might be suspecting that it doesn't happen.
Are you thinking of silencing the Mad Scientist? I think we've seen all the secrets here.
Right.
It looked like that was briefly putting a Mad Scientist.
No, we haven't seen Ice Block number two.
Oh, right, he hasn't seen that.
Yeah.
We've seen it.
Yeah. So Brian's original question.
We've seen it all game.
We've been staring right at it, so I was thinking about that.
Those of us with caster vision have seen it. But
I wonder if, I think Cereza doesn't want to swipe, because obviously if he has this information, he'd probably swipe first and then silence his Azure Drake and then attack into the Aldrazi, but he doesn't know it. And now he's going to get punished again with this Frost Nova, because he's seen the freezes, and he's really hoping Dr. Hippie doesn't have the Frost Nova.
Is he just dead? I think that's enough damage. Forgotten Torch.
That's also a good question.
Ten.
Yeah, he's dead.
Yeah, no, wow. Yep.
Oh my god.
Rob spotted lethal.
This game has completely turned upside down, and now all of a sudden we go to game number 5 with Dr. Hippie escaping the Freeze Mage vs. Druid matchup.
And that's got to be rough mentally for Cereza there. We saw his just very, very passionate reaction to, you know, when he realized, you know, he failed to break the ice block that turn. Which, as I said, I can see how that can happen to you, because it happened to me right there, too.
Right. Cereza, he's such a, as you said, a passionate individual. He's a very passionate player. And there is kind of the concern with someone like him who's very emotional and wears his heart kind of on his sleeve, that making that mistake in front of all the people watching at home at this level could potentially put him in a spot where he's not thinking clearly. So Cereza's got to tighten up and just calm down those nerves. Dr. Hippie, on the other hand, down 2-0, comes back 2-2. The man has ice in his veins, Dan.
I think we need to get Cereza a glass of water, because it feels like he's choking.
Wow, okay.
He needs to simmer down. He let Alexstrasza live, which is almost another way to certainly guarantee that your opponent kills you, because it's like you're taking 16 damage per turn, and he had the opportunity to go back and reevaluate his plays. I'm really looking forward to see what the sidebar thinks, because they're probably going to analyze a little bit of these points of, like, even if you mess up here, the most important thing is not about, you know, trying to erase your mistake. It's about making the best play from that point onwards, and it was very visibly noticeable that he was shaken up by that.
Definitely. And that's the sort of thing that, you know, when you're playing at the highest level, someone who you know, makes a mistake. In some cases, players will make a mistake and try and, like, kind of cover up that it was a mistake.
I
meant to do that.
Al Sky High with the life tap.
I love it.
Was it BM?
Like, oh, yeah, I'm going to just BM fully. Go for it.
Yeah.
But I got to say, though, that Dr. Hippie has been playing very well. I think relative to how much pressure he's been under, some unfavorable positions, just like the mark of any good Freeze Mage player at this stage of the tournament, they remain calm, play their outs as best as they can. And also, I love the fact that he showed Icelands as the top deck lethal in quotation marks, even though he had the Forgotten Torch to end the game anyways, just to kind of put Cereza even further on tilt. I love it.
All right, well, we will see Dr. Hippie's Hunter deck now, and looks like it's going to be a mid-range style of Hunter deck, most likely, with that Hunter's Mark there, and Snake Trap as well. Not much of a face card.
I was going to say, that's a good observation, Brian. That Hunter's Mark, from my experience as a master Hunter player, tells you that this is a mid-range Hunter.
Although, I do want to counterpoint. I think if we look at the reticle and where it's pointing, there's a giant red arrow pointing at something, Rob. Can you tell me?
Oh, that's the face, Dan.
Yeah. So I think in the end, you know, Hunters can't change its stripes.
No, that Control Hunter
it's still
with Reno.
The face.
I played against one of these guys playing Control Hunter the other day, and it's really discouraging to me.
Did Dr. Hippie mulligan Snake Trap and get Snake Trap? So that he's playing multiple Snake Traps.
He's playing two Snake Traps. Right. And he also is a little bit tilted because of the, you know, boy, that's annoying. This is supposed to be a good matchup for Hunter on paper.
Yeah, generally, I believe that mid-range Hunter often has an advantage against Druid, because if it is able to get on the board quickly, it's able to just leverage that hero power to close the game out. So, and especially with cards like that Hunter's Mark that give you the ability to break through big taunts like Druid of the Claw, you can definitely swing the matchup in your favor very much.
Yeah, that's a good point. But this Innervate is going to do wonders for Cereza. He's going to have not only the silence, but this 2-4 body challenges pretty much anything that Hunter can do early on, especially on turn 2. But maybe that's kind of like okay for Dr. Hippie, because assuming Mad Scientist only had the 2 Snake Traps, maybe he was going to pull anything out anyways.
I imagine he probably has something other than Snake Trap.
I think a 3 secret
build. I would guess a bear would be my guess. Okay. Usually, you typically see Snake and Bear paired together so that there's never a right play for your opponent if you have one secret.
Yeah.
We do see, you know, the second secret come out. As you guys said, it might just be second Snake. Oh, no, it's explosive Trap.
All right, look. Okay.
Kimber's right.
Yeah,
usually,
Snake Explosive or Snake Bear are the pairings.
If people can figure out that Snake Trap is one of the secrets, then what they do, they just never attack your minion. And they always go for your hero portrait instead. A little bit irony.
They just make the correct play every
ironic
turn.
For Hunters. Like, well, usually I'm the one doing that, but they just ignore my minions and go face. But Explosive Trap puts you in a situation where you have to.
This is a very unusual build from Dr. Hippie here. You know, seeing the double Snake Trap, Explosive Trap, double Abusive Sergeant, Glaivezooka. This isn't really a familiar build that I've really seen at all.
No, it feels like it has that hybrid Hunter feel with a Hunter's Mark, which is not exactly traditional either. So I definitely am in your camp, Cuba. I think this is a little bit unusual, but I like it because I think you have to bring something slightly unusual because Hippie might be expecting Secret Paladins. He might be expecting something else.
And Cerasa's draw here is really poor. The second Savage Roar, not what he's looking for at all. In particular, if that is... No, he knows that is a Snake Trap now. He's attacked with Minion to the face.
Which has to mean that playing down that Mind Control tech feels especially bad now.
He'd definitely love to be able to use that MC tech to at least get a little bit of value, but
right.
I mean, maybe he's just never going to attack a minion again, which is just what we were talking about.
Yeah, he has two Savage Roars. In fact, he has just as an aggressive hand as the Hunter does. I mean, Hunter has all damage hand, which is fantastic if you want to race your opponent.
Well, go ahead.
I'm just saying, but in this situation, right now he has too many weapon charges, and he has to really dump his hand before he uses Quick Shot so ultimately he can get value.
Yeah, the problem for Cerasa here is he just doesn't have any minions. And those Savage Roars by themselves, just your hero attacks for 2 damage. So he's really looking to pick something up that would allow him to actually enable those. Wrath is good. Wrath allows him to remove one of these minions without breaking the Snake Trap and drawing a card.
It's a very specific subset of minions that he was looking to draw. We saw he had Sheeta next Rammus. Mm-hmm. Even if he had like Big Game Hunter, sometimes you just play it. Argent Horse Rider applies the pressure, and Dr. Hippie is going to start ranking up the damage very quickly. You don't feel like it does because it's just increments in 2, but he does, you know, 8 damage this turn.
Yeah, next 2
turn
and 2 got, and 2 and 2.
Yeah.
It's also one of those matchups where as the Hunter, you get really excited. You're like, all right, I'm pushing damage. I'm hitting him for like 4 to 5 every turn. And then the Druid plays down like Dr. Boom and then Savage Roar, Force of Nature with like an Innervate the next turn after. But yeah, Dr. Hippie pushing a lot of damage right now. And that Snake Trap may not necessarily seem super impactful, but I think it's a lot more impactful than people at home might suspect.
Yeah, until Cerasa draws a swipe, and even then,
oof.
Yikes. It's looking really hard for Cerasa to stop this pressure. He skipped too many turns. He was playing face Druid a little bit too much, hero powering hitting the face, and Dr. Hippie is now in a position where he is going to leverage all the damage possible to set up for a kill next turn.
It's really interesting seeing the sort of pairing of this hybrid Hunter with Freeze Mage in his lineup. You know, you generally think of people playing usually pretty similar sorts of decks, but speaking of similar sorts of decks and cards here, Cerasa picking up yet another card just the wrong time.
Yeah.
Seems to be the theme of his draw this game.
It's looking real bad. He's trying to go up a river without a paddle.
Wow. This is what you do at your hotel every night, isn't it? This is why you don't hang out with us.
I write a lot of lines, Rob, and all of them make it.
No, they're all, wow. First name greatest, Dan. First name greatest.
That's a 3 damage Wrath overkill. Doesn't really matter. He needs Innervate and Hero Power, but that is going to be the game and the series. Dr. Hippie completes the comeback. And that's a pill that Cerasa has to swallow.
I'm not acknowledging anymore. So Cerasa will not be eliminated from this tournament. The hope of Portugal rides on. He will head into the lower group of Group A, where he will play the person who loses the next series. But Dr. Hippie is now one match away from getting to the top 4, which we will see tomorrow.
Yeah, and Cerasa there, got to be a tough loss. You know, he had that moment in the Druid versus Freeze Mage game. He was visibly shaken by that mistake, and hopefully he'll be able to shake that off before he moves into his next match.
Yeah, and I think it's not over for him. It's an opportunity to prove yourself tomorrow. No one's eliminated on day number 1. We just get the first matches out of the way as we get familiar with all their faces and stories. But you have to feel a little bit pained on Cerasa's behalf. But also at the same time, I think Dr. Hippie just again, there's nothing to his fault. I feel like he played very well relative to his decks, his outs, his lineups. Maybe he was put in tough positions, but I have to commend him that he made quite a good impression on me.
Yeah, I really like the different styles between the two players. We'll look at Nyxlay versus Nyman coming up next, but Cerasa, Dr. Hippie, two players do different styles, and in the end, Dr. Hippie's ice-cold play style, just very calm. No, that wasn't a pun.
I know. I'm just happy to see you, Rob. And I'm happy to see Nymph, who's standing fire's eye with the winner. It's Dr. Hippie.
All right, guys, I'm here with Dr. Hippie. Congratulations on the win. That was really amazing. And I do have a couple of questions for you. So first, coming into this matchup, what were your expectations? Did you think you were favored?
Я даже не знаю. Ну, я ожидал, конечно, победу. Я уже выиграл Серезу раньше. Хотелось бы повторить еще раз, и вышло.
I expected to beat Serezu because I've done that before, and I did it again.
All right, nice. And how do you feel now after this match was pretty difficult, I think, where you were actually losing 0-2, and then there was this one moment in the Freeze Mage versus Druid matchup that allowed you to win the whole series. So how do you feel now winning that tough spot?
Ну, чувствую себя, конечно, хорошо. Я уже думал, не выиграю после двоих поражений. Да еще и против Друида нужно было играть, что довольно трудно. Так что я чувствую себя хорошо.
I feel great. I almost gave up hope, especially playing against Druid. But now it feels amazing.
All right. And the next match is Nyxley versus Nyman. Who do you want to face? Who has a worse lineup versus your lineup?
Я пока не видел лайнапа Неймана. Я что не могу сказать точно, но я бы не предпочитал бы играть против него.
I haven't seen Neyman's lineup, but I definitely not prefer to play against him.
All right, guys. So that's Dr. Hippie, and he is one match away from qualifying to the top four. But let's talk to TJ and see what the guys have to say about this amazing match.
Thank you very much, Nimsh. And once again, a big congratulations to Dr. Hippie for taking that victory. I'm joined on the sidebar by Soddle. Soddle, that was a really exciting match to start it off. There was some high-level play for a lot of it, but there were some interesting moments. What was your overall thoughts about that matchup and Dr. Hippie taking the win?
Yeah, I think it was a really great opening. I think even though Dr. Hippie wasn't successful with the Freeze Mage at the first attempt, he showed a great understanding of the deck, as we'd come to expect, from the stats that we've seen that show he is primarily a Mage player.
Yeah, most of his games on ladder are with Mage. So let's jump into a clip from one of the first games here. This was the Rogue versus Zoo, and this was a play that Syriza made. He actually decided on this board to go for what seemed like a pretty risky Blade Flurry play. He had already used his Blade Flurry to set the context, his first one. Mm-hmm. And the second one he uses just to clear off two imps.
Right.
So, Soddle, I want you to go into the reasoning behind this type of bold play coming out from Syriza.
Sure. So committing the second Blade Flurry at this point is pretty ambitious against Zoo, because once they've seen both Blade Flurries be used, they're pretty much free to develop on the board. But in this situation, you can see he's down at 12 life, so if he didn't answer the 1-1s here, he'd be dead to Leroy Power Overwhelming. And even like furthering his read even further, TJ, you pointed out something about the hand that was interesting.
Yeah, so the thing about Zoo Warlock's hand is they don't have very many situational cards. And when a Zoo Warlock keeps cards in their hand for a long time, you know that it's usually either Owl, Burn Spell, or Burn Creature. And he saw the Owl and the Dr. Boom, which were on the far left of his hand, in there for a long time. So he probably made the read that those were Leroy and Power Overwhelming, right, or a combination of something. And that's why he went with that play. So it's a bit interesting, and I sort of agreed with it just because at that point you're a rogue. You sometimes sort of have to take risks, and that's one of the risks that I think he took.
It looks like a low-value Blade Flurry, but I think also we were maybe arguing there was only one fan of knives in the deck because we saw some of the tech cards like Big Game Hunter, but we saw over the course of the game he drew two fans as well. Mm. So I think he felt confident he had enough AoE left, and like you said, playing around that read of the opponent's deck cards in hand. So.
Yeah, definitely agree. So let's take a look at one of the more controversial plays of the series, is what we can call it. This was in game number 4, and this is Syriza had a pretty comfortable lead. He was up 2-1 in the series, and it looked like he had a big lead even in the game with the Druid. And he made a little bit of a sequencing. I want to call it an error, but we're going to talk about this play a little bit.
Yeah.
So, Soddle, walk me through this play as it happens before the clip cuts.
So, Innovate, Force of Nature, Savage Draw gives him the potential to clear the block here. But what happens is really a classic case of overthinking, because you see him debate whether or not to kill the Mad Scientist at the end here. And killing this Mad Scientist is actually quite a high-level play in the Freeze Mage Druid matchup, because you prevent the second ice block being pulled before you clear the first one. So this is classic overthinking, because he remembered something kind of advanced about the matchup, but then forgot something really basic, which is there's a second copy of Ice Barrier in the deck as well, which just stops you from popping the block.
Yeah.
Which against Freeze Mage is just such a huge deal, because not popping the block is one whole extra turn for the Freeze Mage to rely on.
Yeah, and you could see his reaction, you know, as the second secret is brought out, and it's a good read to set context. He had already seen the first ice barrier.
Yep.
So this play could have been seen as sort of a huge risk even. Mm-hmm. A lot of people will point out and say, oh, it was a misplay, but it could have been seen as just a big risk. If, for instance, Dr. Hippie had the second ice barrier in his hand and the second block in the deck,
right,
then it actually would have been a good play because it wouldn't have pulled the second ice barrier and the mad scientist would have been off the board. So after popping the block, the second one would have had to been dug for with card draw. So it could have been considered a big risk. Do you agree with me on that one, Saddle?
I mean, it's one of the reasons why it's so important not to get results-oriented in Hearthstone. You can say in this situation it would have been right, in this situation it would have been wrong. That's not really what's important. It's about the average outcome, right? Is this line the most consistent most of the time? So I think like I'd have to go ahead and call it a bit of an error, but like it's understandable because you can follow his thought process through as to what he was thinking.
Yeah, but as you're saying, the majority of the time that second ice barrier is going to be in the deck and ends up being one of the plays that allowed Dr. Hippie to come back and eventually take the match. So we'll see both of those players later on this weekend. Tomorrow they'll play in the winner and lower match respectively for their group. But we're going to head into the second match of the day. But before we do that, take a look at some of the highlights from the last match.